Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Computer Wednesday. In today's episode we're gonna talk about a silent revolution, which is Raspberry Pi. So let's dive right into it. So Raspberry Pi was launched in February 2013, so it's kind of old thing and it is from UK, but you have to understand one thing about it. This is a whole CPU, central processing unit, and whole box that you we call the computer itself packed onto a one board. Basically everything you need for a computer is in this, from memory to processing to RAM to graphics card to a display output, everything in one unit. Other than display itself and input devices itself, they are giving you basically the CPU, the box, that CPU. So it's more or less like this, compute sticks. You can check my video on that here. So the idea with this is basically giving you a full-fledged computer, a desktop grade computer, of course not like cutting edge, but a very basic simple computer on a single board. And to understand the size, just think of it, the footprint of these things are exactly the same as a credit card. So credit card that you have, credit card, ATM card, or whatever you have right now in your pocket, basically that's the same size. They do come on an even smaller form factor like this, but those are basically used for things that where you need portable devices. This is more akin to, you know, general purpose. So, but be mindful, if you want to use this as a computer, please analyze this before you jump into it, because in most case scenario where you need just a computer, you will be happy with compute stick. But if you need something very specific, these may provide a better solution. So please do check, don't just jump into it. Okay, this is a computer, just jump into it. And it's a bit small, as I already told you, it's a credit card size, and it's very cheap. So what the heck that thing is? Well, many of you know we have microcontroller in our day-to-day lives everywhere, basically from your washing machine to your power electric meter to even basically things of this nature, remote and all that. All of them have what we call microcontrollers, basically where you give it a certain code and it handles the input and output. It is very efficient system. There is no operating system. It's basically firmware level. You tell it a data, it does what you asked it to do. So Arduino comes into the picture quite early. Like Arduino is quite old, and they give you this idea that you can access microcontrollers. Not, you don't need to be like Intel or AMD or Texas Instrument to have a microcontroller. You can have this microcontroller, you can program the microcontroller using your normal computer, and you will have these pins. Now these pins are the reason why this is even, you know, worth mentioning, because before that, could you have access microcontroller? Yes, but you would have needed a special tool to program it, a special tool to access that microprocessor, as in like to connect a, you know, motor controllers, connecting temperature sensors. These sorts of sensor needed a very specific hassle to deal through. Now when Arduino comes into the picture, it's like, okay, this is one board, we will call it Arduino brain, and you're just gonna use your desktop PC to program it, and you can connect whatever you need to, from humidity sensor to voltage regulators to whatever you need to control. So this revolutionized the electronic world. However, this still had a limiting factor. Even though this is cheaper than Raspberry Pi, it had the limiting factor that it needed a computer. This was not a complete unit. It does not have an operating system. You cannot edit this on it itself. So let's say you find out, hey, I need to tweak some value. Again, go back to basically computer and retweak the code. So for this reason, this disk became very popular, but not jaw-dropping as Raspberry Pi. And as you can see, we can stack multiple things, which we call Arduino shields, where each shield could have a specific thing. Like this shield will give you SD card. Shield below it will give you speaker or humidity sensor, whatever you need. So this was very good, but it was lacking a computer. So Raspberry Pi comes along and gives you the ability to access all this hardware, and you know, even make your own hardware, but it gives you a computer inbuilt with it. That's the crucial aspect. The Raspberry Pi as a computer is not a very great computer, but as a replacement for Arduino, it's legendary. Now Arduino is specifically built for one thing, so it's very efficient, and from power consumption point to, you know, your latency, as in like how long it takes to execute a command on this, Raspberry Pi will be slower, simply because Raspberry Pi has to deal with basically operating system also. So this will be very fast, but for more often not, Raspberry Pi is basically this plus computer, and that latency is not like, you know, okay, this will do in 1/10 of a second, that will take 10 minutes. It's basically, this will take 1/10 of a second, that will take half a second. So it's not that big of a deal. Now the fact that it's a low power general purpose computer, that means it can be just used as a teaching tool. It can do a lot of things. Like there are people who just need computer for their cashier machine, again use Raspberry Pi. So, and let's say all you want to do is like have a computer that is completely secure and nobody can hack it. Like you want to use your own operating system, low grade one. Like what I mean by low grade is like, don't try to run basically a full-fledged Windows Server Edition or full-fledged Linux. This does have a processor, however, that's not x86 processor. That x86 being your PC architecture. So it's more or less aligned to the ARM processing system that we use for mobile phones. So it is powerful, but it's not a full-fledged desktop yet. It does not use the same instruction set. In future, it may, but I would not hold my breath. It's not meant for that. So the fact that using the efficiency of a mobile processing unit, it's giving you a full-fledged Windows PC, full-fledged Linux PC, not to full extent. Be mindful, do not expect this to, you know, replace your $1,000 gaming PC, but it's a full-fledged PC. Let's say all you do is check email and reply to emails, boom, Raspberry Pi can take care of it. So, and on top of that, when these Arduino came in, a lot of community was created where people were like, you know, taking these and developing products. When our Raspberry Pi came in, it, you know, exploded those community that was using this. They used this plus Raspberry Pi and they got like amazing results out of it. So there is a very large community of developer from every country. Like even from India, you can find at least 50,000-60,000 developer that are contributing to the software library, to the hardware shields. To there are many Kickstarter successful ones, some flop ones, like some companies are also mass producing shields for these sort of things. So it's very big. Like the impact of Raspberry Pi cannot be denied, and it became big, like 10 million pieces sold in just a few days, kind of big. So it triggered a revolution. Now how the heck it can trigger a revolution? First, when I say cheap, it actually was cheap. Like the original was $25. After the upgrades, they are still selling it at $35. So that's a very cheap price. Even in Indian rupees, that's less than 4,000 rupees. So suffice to say, when they say cheap, it's cheap for almost everybody. This was meant for as a learning toy for basically kids, and adult find a lot of use of it. So it kind of took off, and because of volume production, they can successfully keep their price low. So they're not even aiming for like, you know, we're gonna release a high version of it. They're just gonna release the same thing, and they're gonna keep upgrading it, keep polishing it, and try to keep the price as low as possible, $35. They're not gonna move away from that. And the when I talk about upgrade, when the first Raspberry Pi came out, it had 256 MB of RAM. Right now you can buy something like this, which is what we call compute module, and you will get roughly 1 GB of RAM in some models. So why the heck you want that form factor? Again, up to you. Let's say this, basically this is a media player that is sold to public right now. You can order that media player, and it's not the latest and greatest of a media player ever made, but this is quite unique media player because it has its own hard drive capacity which you can upgrade, and it's like it supports a normal operating system which is created by certain developers by, you know, modifying existing thing, retweaking the specific hardware. Now Raspberry Pi already has a hardware input and output. Now let's say you don't need that, like you don't need that pin things for this. So what the Raspberry Pi community did is they requested for just the compute module, basically just the processor and the graphics unit and voltage regulations and all that. Basically just give the computer, don't give any ports. So this module that you see, and if you think it looks like a RAM, because it using the same form factor of a RAM, like they did it very cleverly, because if you use the same existing hardware, so all the company, Chinese company who has to manufacture it, they will do it very cheaply because it's, they have the mold, they have the electronics already done. Now from that you can redesign the PCB trace. So for these people, they have HDMI audio in and audio out, whatever you need, and they have this unique LED ring around it that can be running on this. And let's say in future the Raspberry Pi creates another version, as I told you, they keep upgrading it, you can just replace this inside it with just another thing. So it's actually appearing in product. Like there is this Mycroft, this is basically a primitive version of Alexa. In some regard, this is better, but it came before these things. So, and you can, as you can see, like if you go to Raspberry website itself, like there are so many operating system, like developers are giving their work for free. So the power of community here cannot be denied. Like you can't just go anywhere and like, okay, this is the hardware and this is the software for it. In Raspberry, you can do that. Like you, there are people who created operating system just for the fact that you need to run a weather station out of it. Enough people started using Raspberry Pi as a weather station. That community got together. They started contributing, data points. They started contributing with how Raspberry Pi should do. Raspberry Pi itself helped them, and now lo and behold, now we have an operating system that is very good at data cataloging, very efficient, consumes less power. So as a tool, not as a computer, as a tool, this became a integral part of many development right now. So let's say you are a student, okay, and you are like, okay, I need to develop integrated applications. Basically, let's say you are building a inverter or UPSR. Basically, how would you measure whether your battery voltage is high or low, or your AC input output, how is the voltage there? Now measuring them, you can simply connect it with a amp meter and all that, okay, but how are you gonna catalog it? To catalog it, you need a completely different set of tools. Raspberry Pi can do it for you. Basically, you can just buy a Raspberry Pi, write the software so it can catalog that data, and connect what we, in Raspberry Pi, it's called hats. Like in Arduino, it's called shield. In Raspberry world, it's called hat. And using that hat, like you can directly connect a DC voltage meter, AC voltage meter, and using all those data, you can directly compare the efficiency of the UPS itself, how long it's taking the charge to battery, how efficient it is during the charging process, how efficient it is during the discharges process, and you can connect a microphone, so you can figure out how loud it is. You know, so these sort of ability to achieve this sort of thing, like are there tools specific for this? Yes, but they are very expensive. Raspberry Pi is cheap. So the tool aspect, as you can see, like people are making supercomputer out of this. Now of course this supercomputer can be beaten by a Threadripper, but point is, if you go to any computer university and they're like, okay, I want to learn how to sync supercomputer, that's the biggest hurdle with supercomputing. You have to make sure all the processors are processing data efficiently. They are not wasting time trying to wait, okay, let's say processor number one is processed the data, I will wait, okay, processor one gave me the data, now I'm processing. Like you have to handle what we call parallelization, and the best way to test parallelization is have parallelized system. Like it's very simple, you have to have multiple computer, same computer, to test it out. Now of course you can't just go out there and buy Threadrippers for your supercomputer, even though your final computer may have it. Let's say you are developing a software, you're learning about it, is it it's not worth it to spend millions of dollars for that? Raspberry Pi allows you to do that. Now of course this is not a practical supercomputer, but this is a very awesome learning tool, because even if you try to buy cheap, let's say compute stick or like old second-hand desktops, you will barely get 50-60. Here you can, people are getting like 600-700 node computers, and handling 700-800 nodes are tangibly more complex than handling 50-60 computers. So, and also this is power efficient. So you can figure out how you're gonna code a system, how you're gonna parallelize the load, how you're gonna make sure the clocks don't go out of sync. They're a hell of a headache trying to make supercomputer. You can get a very good hands-on training using Raspberry Pi. So, and Raspberry Pi was originally targeted for children to learn programming, and the reason why I'm saying it's this is a better programming tool than a computer is simply because you can't in your computer easily just go like, okay, using my computer I'm gonna code turn this light on or off. On Raspberry Pi you can do that because it has pins. Those pins, and there are multiple shields. They're like you can connect a Wi-Fi shield, then directly buy Wi-Fi based smart plugs and plug everything in your home using that, and then code Raspberry Pi in such a way that at night turn off my light, at 12 p.m. turn out all off my lights, at let's say 7 in the morning start my air condition, whatever you need. So those sort of thing exist, but they are not cheap, and in some scenarios they don't exist. Like you can't just go out there and buy, hey, I need 700 computers. People are like, what the hell? Like you can buy them, but they're gonna be very expensive. And so you can practice this thing on Raspberry Pis. people are making a robot. Like, this robot is up for sale right now, and I'm not sure because the half of the Kickstarter have failed, so be mindful of that. But you can make a robot out of it using Raspberry Pi as a brain. And this weather station application has like taken off. Like, it's ludicrously successful. Right now you can just buy a complete weather station, as in it will tell you the wind speed, wind direction, humidity, temperature, whatever have you, and you know, solar flux and things of that nature. And using Raspberry Pi, it's collecting all the data, processing it, and then giving you out a basically graph that you can share through internet using Google Documents. Because it's a computer, Arduino could do almost all the things, but when it comes to sharing that data, it will need another module to connect to internet, another module to archive the data, another module to, like, you know, store that data on a SD card. So for this reason, weather station that are using Raspberry Pi is kind of awesome. Like, you can have hundreds of these made on a very low budget, where you can, like, let's say for some instance you want to develop wind farm and you want to scout out the site. Like, I think wind farms here will work. Of course, you need to provide data for it. Satellite data is good, but you need, like, you know, on-spot data. You can use multiple of these because these are cheap. You can just put hundreds of them and you will get a very accurate data. Many of them come like Raspberry Pi right now, the latest version comes with onboard Wi-Fi, so you don't even need to connect a Wi-Fi shield. It has Wi-Fi inbuilt. Heck, you may even be like, you know, okay, Wi-Fi consumes too much energy and I want this to be powered from a small solar cell. Use Bluetooth and you only have one large receiving station that's collecting all the data. Or just use Ethernet. It also has Ethernet. So all things come as a tool, it's phenomenally awesome. As many of you know, many of us have a lot of skill in terms of paper knowledge and in terms of book knowledge, but have we ever turned that knowledge into anything useful? Raspberry Pi allows us a very good tool in order to make our thoughts into reality. Basically, I always wanted to have a inverter that I give you in the example, where I can actually see, okay, what is my voltage input versus what my AC input is, because that way I can figure out how what kind of efficiency my AC to DC conversion is giving me, what kind of efficiency I'm getting from I'm converting DC to AC. Is sine wave more efficient or square wave? For all those things, of course, there are tools that you can buy, but those are very expensive. And let's say you want to build a smart meter, they can cost upwards of 5,000 rupees to like $300 to $400. Raspberry Pi is $35. Even with hats combined, you are talking about $200 to $300. So, and you can get them even cheaper if you know right place to buy, or you can build your own shield. So, all things combined, Raspberry Pi have quietly started a revolution, and it's a very good revolution, and I'm happy that this happened, because it's one thing to teach someone, like, okay, this is how electronics world work, another to, like, okay, make a robot, make a supercomputer, make a weather stations. If you show your kid this sort of thing, they will be more interested in programming, because they're actually getting the, what programming does in real world, done on a small scale for them. Like, you can actually say, oh, this is how, weather station works. Oh, this is how, like, let's say, satellite tracker you can make. There are many people who use this for ISS tracking, basically International Space Station. So this sort of thing is very crucial for learning. So this was my presentation on Raspberry Pi, the quiet revolution. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't like it, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. I would urge you to leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Computer Wednesday, and I would ask you to please subscribe, press the bell icon if you're free, and as always, thanks for watching. Oh, and please remember to share. Thank you.